Hello, Bible readers. It's Wednesday, October 21st. We are reading the book of Joshua, chapters 16 through 18, and the Gospel of Luke, chapter 17, 1 to 37. And the Luke stories that we read today begin with teaching and healing, of course. You've got a story about how repentance and forgiveness are still going to be needed, even for those who are in the kingdom of God, which I find to be an important piece, especially in Luke, as the response of a Jesus follower is so important in the Gospel of Luke. And yet still, the Gospel of Luke is saying, even if your response is good, there is still you will still need to use the tools that are repentance when you've done stuff wrong and forgiveness for those who have done wrong to you. This is where the kind of story where Lutherans have the idea of saint and sinner at the same time. That I am, although a saved child of God, also a sinner, a simultaneous saint and sinner. We don't just make that up, although that is, I think, most people's experience. There is no completely 100% good person, no completely 100% bad person, but where this idea of saint and sinner at the same time can come from are places like this, where Jesus is saying, basically, don't self-justify. Just because you've made a choice or a response or a decision, whatever word you want to use about following Jesus, being a member of the kingdom of God, that doesn't mean you're too good to repent. That doesn't mean you're too good to forgive. You're not safe and secure from the bad choices that do happen in this life. We also have the story talked about Jesus's power to heal, as the lepers are all in need of healing. And then, of course, the other half of that is the response of those who have been healed. We are to give thanks. That's what this story is getting at. Not to simply walk away feeling like, oh, I was entitled to a healing anyway, because my life has been so hard and so awful. And so it's about time, God, that you have finally shown up and done the healing that you would think God would do. That the Pharisees in one of the stories we read today, that they don't see the kingdom of God in what's happening, shows that as Jesus kind of gets after them for this, this isn't seeing and believing in and being present in the kingdom of God is not just an internal, heady, or in the heart kind of thing. Jesus is making the point that healings are happening, exorcisms are happening, people are converting. This is not that the kingdom of God is present among us and amidst us. It's not a theoretical idea. It's not a hypothetical idea. It's happening now. And so when now isn't even the right answer. It's this question of when will the kingdom of God happen? It's not a chronological question to Jesus. It's a conversion question. Where? Well, the kingdom of God happens wherever the people are gathered around God's word, where God's word is alive and happening. That's why First Lutheran has this tagline, faith alive. That's where the kingdom of God happens. So it's not like on this date, in this place. That's not how Jesus thinks of this. It's where people are gathered when they convert and are moved into the direction of God. The Joshua section, we've got you know, who's the land going to? How much of it? What, you know, land for Ephraim, land for Manasseh, firstborn to Joseph. The hill country shall be enough for the sons of Joseph. Surveying lots and Shiloh and all this stuff. It's, you know, it's a lot of that. I thought I'd get at the why this is written and what its importance is. So I thought I'd read this paragraph. The fulfillment of the curse of Canaan expresses at best a backhanded compliment. The Davidic historian gives these two tribes of Joseph, always troublesome to Judah, the credit for fulfilling the curse, but as little credit as possible. Each of the likely rulers behind the composition of this section, Josiah and Hezekiah, knows that he must compromise with these powerful folk of the old hills, the Israelite hills. So the writer acknowledges their power, but at the same time recalls their weaknesses. In other words, when these stories are written, they're written to explain, well, how did the people who live in the hill country, where'd they come from? Which son of Joseph are they from? And then the people who live in the lowlands, what are they about? And so when the kings of Israel, Josiah and Hezekiah, when they commission for this kind of thing to be written that we're reading, they want a slant put on it, not just a historical, here's what happened and how. They want to kind of explain, yeah, you're powerful people of today's date, your ancestors, but you're also to blame for some things. And so here's some weaknesses to lift up. So interesting to think why Joshua and Judges and other books are written. I am one with my God. My God is with us, all of us, at all times and in all places.